invite you to greet your neighbor with the love of Christ this morning. Give a handshake or a hug.
As you make your way back to your seats, would you remain standing as you are able as we affirm our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed as our guide? Will you join with me as we affirm our faith? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. By the way, that was really impressive, team. Well done. Well done. Good job, team. Well, you know, so sure enough, as soon as Alyssa opened us in worship, the computer froze solid, and it's been rebooting, and so praise God that Seth? Yes! I have the thumbs up from the booth. And can we just acknowledge what a wonderful time and leadership Alyssa offered on that song with no words?
Of course.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
It's a gift to be with you this morning. My name is Jason, and I just am so happy to be able to worship with you. Welcome to Covenant. If you're a guest with us, we want to offer especially a warm welcome to you. There's a couple of cards in the seat backs in front of you. The first is a prayer card. We know that the Lord seeks a relationship with us, that he desires to hear from us, and we know that the prayers of the righteous availeth much. We have testimonies to that truth here amongst us in the midst of the congregation, and so we celebrate that, and we want to pray with you. The pastoral team, the staff, the prayer warriors of the church all pray over these prayers each and every week. And so I hope that you will fill that out. There's a basket on your way out of worship today. Take time to let us know what you're praying for. What is the prayer of your heart? Because we want to join you in prayer. Also, the Lord has called Covenant to be about the work of building a community, connecting in Christ. So we want to connect with you, and we want to see this community come together in connection with the Lordship of Jesus Christ, his grace, his love, his mercy. And so there's an I'm new card in the seat back in front of you. If you are new, if this is your first time, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. If you would fill out some contact information, Pastor Zach would love to reach out and connect with you this week. And those cards can also be placed there at the door. I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward for this morning's offering. And as they do, I just have an announcement I want to share with you. You might remember that earlier this year, at the end of May, Covenant voted to merge with the Woodlands Methodist Church and to become a campus of the Woodlands Methodist Church. And that action has involved a great amount of behind-the-scenes effort and attentiveness with what transition looks like. What does this mean for the church? What does it mean for our campus? And so, Vision Night coming up at the end of this month on August the 25th at 5, I think it's 5 to 6:30 here in the space. We will have dinner together, so I hope that you will scan the QR code and let us know you're coming. We want to be sure that we have fajitas for you, okay? We don't want to under-order. If you could let us know you're coming, that would be great. This will be a time when we'll be able to cast vision for what this merger means, what it means to be a campus of the Woodlands Methodist Church over the course of the fall and entering into the new year. Cast vision for the ministry that God is inviting us into. So I hope that you will take time to be with us, make that a priority on the 25th, but also to register and let us know that you'll be in attendance. We've already gotten great response on this, but I know that many of you are going to want to be there. Please let us know through RSVP. This is a really exciting week in the life of our community with the Conroe ISD, Tomball ISD, Klein ISD all heading back to school. And so we're going to offer some prayers. We're going to have some celebrations and hear a covenant. This is also Promotion Sunday where we're going to have some kindergartners and some sixth graders acknowledged as they're entering into new seasons in the life of the church. But before we do any of that, we need to pause and acknowledge that our teachers, our school administrators and faculty have already been back at work. They've already been preparing the way for a great year for our students. And we want to pray over them. And so if you are a teacher, an administrator, and I know that some of you are like, I don't like standing and acknowledgement, you're going to have to get over it because we want to bless you. We want to pray over you. So if you would stand at this time so that we could just extend a hand in blessing over you. If you are a teacher or an administrator, I see some of y'all, and y'all are not standing. That is ridiculous. All right, here we go. Yes, there we go. All of y'all remain standing. We're going to extend a hand of blessing as we pray over these leaders in our community. Lord God, we come before you thankful that you have raised up servants for your students, that you have raised up teachers, that you have raised up administrators and faculties. Lord, we bless them. We give thanks for them. And we ask, Lord, that you will make a way this year for them to be fruitful in their interaction with the students and parents that they serve. Lord, we pray for the students that will be under their tutelage. We pray that they would be attentive, that they would be diligent, that they would be respectful and honoring. And Lord, we honor these leaders in our community, and we ask your blessing upon them in the powerful and mighty name of Jesus Christ. We pray this. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Brothers and sisters, let's stand as we join together in worship.
We'll stand as you're able. We're going to worship this morning, and we're going to start by learning a new song. It's one we've done before, but it's been a very long time. And we are going to be entering into a new sermon series today about the church, about the names of the church and the role of the church. And so get familiar with this song. We're going to sing it probably almost every week in this sermon series and make this our anthem and make this our prayer that he would build his church and that we would partner with him to be vessels of building up his church. So let's learn this together and sing it out. Let's make this our anthem this morning.
Upon
church, build your church, build your church.
Worship is all about lifting Him up, giving Him glory, giving Him praise. He is so worthy of it, church. Let's be intentional. Let's be present with our worship.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him,
in your own hearts, give Him thanks and praise. Tell Him what you're thankful for this morning. To receive from you, open to be vessels to give. Lord, we pray over this morning that you would continue to sanctify us, to make us more like you. Lord, whatever you have for us this morning, we remain open. And as your people, we lift up the prayer that you taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Church, you can have a seat.
Amen. I'm going to invite our Cub Kids co-directors, Ms. Jen, Ms. Amber, Nicole, to come on down. We are going to have a few moments to celebrate the beginning of the school year, and this is Promotion Sunday for us here at Covenant, which means we're going to open by acknowledging those that are beginning kindergarten this year. So any students that are beginning kindergarten this year, would you come on up and meet Ms. Jim, Ms. Amber Nicole? They have a gift for you. That's the best. Come on up. Oh, there's another one coming around the corner. Wow. Hey, come right here. Hang out here, Logan, for a second. Hey, how are you, buddy? Hey, you want to take a seat for just a second? This is such... Oh! Logan's like, I got something, Dad! Look what I got! Hey, this is such an awesome week because we get to start school and start kindergarten. We're so proud of you, and we want you to know that we think y'all are going to have the best week ever. Hey, come on down! Oh, we got more. Here they are. You want to take a special gift? Hey, guys, so since today we're celebrating the fact that you're going to get started in kindergarten, we just wanted to let you know how proud we were of you and how it's such a special week. And we want you to know that we're praying for you, that you make great new friends, and you learn so much. and you really get to have the best time ever. So we're going to extend a hand in blessing. If y'all would just reach out a hand, we're going to pray over these students. Lord, we come before you this morning, thankful for these students. We ask your blessing upon them, knowing that you are raising them up so that they would be wise, so that they would be kind, so that they would represent your love in the world. Lord, bless them this week so that they would just know your goodness. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And maybe we should pray for the moms and dads too. Hey guys, any student in the congregation, come on down, bring your backpacks if you have your backpacks. If you don't have your backpacks, don't worry about it. It's okay, just come on down, fill up the space, students young and old. We have some students that just graduated high school that might want to bring a backpack as well. Come on, grab a backpack. Here we go. Everybody get one. And then take a seat after you get your bag tagged. There we are. Oh my goodness. You're such a sweet guy. There we go. Oh man, there we go. There we go, Max. They come with, you got it. Did you get your bag tagged? There you go. Oh. And take a seat after you get your tag so that we know who's gotten it yet and who hasn't. There we go. There we go. There we go. Yes, 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 yes. There, there you go. I love it. I love it. There we go. Come on. You got that senior backpack. Here we are. Yes. Students. There we are. Love it. What's up, guys? How are you? Take a seat. No, no, not back in your... Out up here. Up here. Up here. Come on. Come on. Don't be so quick to rush off. Here we go. Did you get one yet? Yep. Take a seat. Take a seat. Take a seat. Take a seat. And I'll sit here so y'all can face me. Here we go. Did y'all get one?
Of course.
Good. All right. Oh my goodness, look at all these students. Holy smokes, there's so many of you. Well, I want you to know that bag tag that you got, let me see one. It is such a cool picture. And on it, it says mirror image. And I want you to know that's our annual theme at church here this year. And it says 2 Corinthians 3:18. And let me just give you a little quick summary of that verse. Are you ready? It means that we, all of us, are able to reflect God to those we meet. That we reflect God's love, his kindness, his generosity to those we meet. And so I want you to know that as you put those on your backpack and you see them every single day, you can use that as a reminder that you have a role to play for God in your schools. That wherever you go, wherever you're carrying that backpack, you get to bless others by showing them, by reflecting that love to the world. Does anybody have a mirror at home? Raise your hand if you have a mirror. Oh, yeah. And who spends lots of time in the mirror? Okay, oh yeah, there we go. People are holding their friends' hands up and stuff. Well, I want you to know that as a Christian, whenever you look in that mirror, you are seeing God's ability to reflect in you to the world. So whenever other people look at you, they can look at you, look you in the eyes, look you in your bright, smiling faces, and they're able to see God's love. So after church today, not right now, but after church, there's like Rice Krispie treats and fruit snacks for all of y'all, and maybe some leftover for the adults. One, yes. One boyer. And there's a prayer on it, and we're going to make this our prayer today for all of you. So if you would repeat after me as we pray, are you ready? Dear Lord,
open my eyes
to see new friends.
Open my ears.
To hear my teacher.
Open my mind.
To learn new things.
Open my hands.
To help others.
Open my mouth. To speak kind words.
Open my heart.
To love like you.
I know you are always with me.
When I'm at school.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right. If you are in Cub Kids, you're dismissed to go back to Cub Kids with Ms. Jenna and Nicole. And if you are in sixth grade or going to sixth grade or older, you are here in the sanctuary.
Because it's almost certain that you are. But ecclesia and church don't really have a one-to-one correlation in definition. Actually, in English, that's... You would need more words to break it down. That the better way to translate the word ekklesia is to say the called out assembly or the called out ones, people. Those that have been called out, set apart from the world for a distinctive purpose, and they gather together as a group. And that is the church. When we think about the word church, oftentimes we think about buildings or locations, geography, because it's simpler to kind of set our minds to, but that's really not the foundation of what ecclesia, of what church means. Church means that we, you and I, people, have been set apart to assemble and then to infuse the love of God into the world through our distinctiveness. But in Scripture, there are a lot of different names for the church. The church has these distinctive metaphorical names that are accessible and have meaning. And so we're going to walk through over the course of the next 6-7 weeks through the different names for the church in Scripture. And we're going to learn why those names are critical and how we can live out the function of those names in the world as the set-apart assembly of God, the church. So today, the first of these, the first name for the church is body. It comes to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. It says, just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. We, the church, the set-apart assembly, are a body. Oftentimes you'll hear it referred to as we are the body of Christ. And that name is so interesting because it helps to exemplify for us the unity that exists within the body, that we are bound to one another, that we are not to be without each other, that we're not to be separated from each other, but rather we're to be held together by one another. There's unity in the body. And you and I might begin by an examination, like, do I belong to the body? Am I actually a part of the body? And we have an assist from Scripture. The word doesn't leave us without answer. Rather, it clarifies for us, because in verse 13, it lays it out for us that we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body. And it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile or a slave or a free, all were given the one Spirit to drink. See, this baptism of the one Spirit, some of us might get a little confused in the nuance of the language there. We might think that you're not a part of the body if you haven't been physically baptized by water. That's not what's articulated here. It says that this baptism, yes, Jesus articulates that we are to be baptized by water and the Spirit, but what Paul is referring to here for the Corinthian church is that we are being baptized by the Spirit of God so that now God lives in us, that we have intimacy with God. And so that is the way we could answer the question, am I a part of the body? Do I belong to the body? Well, the answer is found in, have you known the intimacy of God in the presence of the Holy Spirit? That anointing of God, that intimacy with God is, in fact, the calling card of what has bound us together in the body. Now, there are times in life where we might feel distant or disengaged, that there are some challenges to our relationship with God, but if we have received, even once, the baptism of the Spirit, we belong to the body. We are unified with one another, and that intimacy is ours. Now, it's critical in verse 13 and 14, excuse me, 14, we hear this question that comes about. It's this question of belonging. And it's so important for us because we feel these things. We feel this. It says, now would the foot say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong? And then later on, it says, does the ear say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong? And oftentimes we could look at one another and we could see their faith lived out, or their faith authentically relevant in who they are in their worship of God or their relationship with God. And we could think, man, I'm not that. So do I belong? I don't seem to have that knowledge, that wisdom, that connection. Do I belong? Am I still a part? Is this for me? But Paul articulates that that's not how we're to be walking through life together, that this isn't a source of comparison for us, that we're not to be looking at Megan and saying, Megan, I see you that way. That means I don't belong because I'm not you. Or Alistair, I see you and I'm not you, so I don't belong. Or Kevin, I see you and I'm not you, so I don't belong. We do that. That's so natural for us as humans to feel that intense emotion, yearning for, desiring belonging, and for Satan to come in and try to challenge that and divide us from one another because of our distinct gifts. You see, Paul is writing this in the context of chapter 11. The Corinthian church was experiencing major divisions. Some of them were easy to acknowledge, and others of them were a little more in the undercurrent of operations. You see, the way that they would get together would show the divisions. They would be highlighted. When they would gather together for a feast, those who didn't have much resources would be excluded, set aside, and those that were that had great resources would have this wild feast that would show their affluence and their accomplishments outside of the function of their role in the body of Christ. And Paul rebukes that. Paul corrects it and says, look, that's not how we gather together. When we get together, all of those differentiations, slave, free, Jew, Gentile, they all wash away and all of us are one. And so Paul uses this passage in chapter 12 to clarify the rebuke, to then reorder the steps of the Corinth church. And we need that reordering as well. Because we face those same temptations to divide ourselves from one another in the church when really, genuinely, God is saying each one of us, with the gifts we bring, because we've been baptized by the Spirit, belong together. You belong to me and I belong to you because we are a part of the same body because we each belong to Christ. It's central hearing this need for belonging. But it's also hilarious the way Paul writes this up. The personification of body parts is really interesting when we break it all down. Whenever body parts start talking to one another, does that like make you chuckle a little bit? It should. Like that's part of the gift of Scripture. We could be inspired to even laughter and humor. Because to hear that a foot is talking to a hand, impossible. And yet it's given this capacity in Scripture so that we could understand how we are each distinctive. But imagine that if a hand was like, I'm not a foot. I'm so glad I'm not a foot because feet are ugly. And you have this nastiness that you have to deal with. You sweat and you are on the ground and you get dirty. Ha, I'm not a foot. Like that's ridiculous. And yet Paul uses this personification to help us get how ridiculous we are, how foolish we are when we are doing these, when we are living out, exercising these divisions that Satan is trying to place between us. This personification even goes further. It talks about this temptation we have to compare and contrast gifts, And understand that we're losing our focus on what is most important here. I remember when my dad was teaching me how to drive. One of the critical lessons he taught me was, the car will go where your eyes go. When you're driving, if you turn your head, just naturally, you're going to start steering the wheel this way. If you turn your head, you're going to start steering the wheel this way. So he said, always keep your eye focused on what's most important. And I think that that's really at the core of the message here, that it's not looking around for what other gifts are in the body, but rather understanding how you've been gifted and what God is calling forth in your life, all aligned with the ultimate aim. If the ultimate aim of the church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ, who will then spread scriptural holiness across the world, that aim, that clear command in Scripture, it orients us. And then it's like, what is my part to play in that? How do I impact that? Do I have gifts of hospitality and fellowship? Do I have gifts of relationship? Do I have gifts of testimony, of teaching, of healing, of prayer? What are my gifts? What part do I have to play? If we are all as a body called to do that, then what is my part to play as a part of the body? We need to keep our aim focused centrally so that we're not distracted or discouraged or divided, because the world is going to try to divide us. We have to know our responsibility and aim at that task specifically. We're bound to one another. We were at the end of our student ministry mission trip this summer. We went to a water park and had a blast. We went to that water park out in Katy by Katy Mills Mall. I had never been there, first time ever there. And I don't go to a lot of water parks, so it was a fresh experience. And we went out to that water park, and there was this awesome slide with a big round tube that can fit up to 8 people, but it's like gauged off of a certain amount of weight. They weigh the tube people before you get in it, and the tube has to weigh under 800 pounds. And so for a lot of our, you know, offensive linemen or first basemen, we could only fit 4 or 5 different people. So we would like manipulate the numbers to try to get the highest possible amount of weight so that we could go the fastest, the highest, and have the most fun. And so we found one combination with a couple of graduating seniors and another high schooler and me. And we got right up to that like 798. It was primo. And so we get in the tube, and the 4 of us are there, and as we get ready to go, one of the guys in the tube looks at everyone else and says, "If you don't stand up, you're a wuss." You know, this is a big tube, and there are like handlebars on the outside. You're supposed to like sit on your bahonkis, and you're supposed to hold on tight because you're supposed to not die. Like, it's open air, and so I'm guessing if you stand up and lose your grip, you could, like, fall over the edge 200 feet to your death. But he looks at all of us, including me, and he says, "If you don't stand up, you're a wuss." And I felt the burden of that, right? I mean, I don't know how I'm supposed to receive that, but I received that as a challenge to my manhood. And so we start going down this slide, and he literally stands up and he pulls the handles up high, and he's like swinging us up against these walls, and the whole thing is just whoom. And he looks at me and says, "Wuss." And so one of the other high schoolers and myself, we do this number. We get off of our backside. We're not as bold as him. We're not standing all the way up, but we get a little squat going, and we get into it. We're looking, and I look back, and I see him, and he's like towering over us. And then I look at there's one more person in the tube with us, just graduated from high school, and he's a rule follower, right? Loves Jesus more than the rest of us. And he is sitting flat on his behind. He will not stand up at all. And we are just swinging all the way down the slide, and we get to the bottom, and we just fall out, and we're all laughing. We had the best time ever. We're ready to go back up. We kind of sprint out of the water, and we're ready to go back in line. The lifeguard blows their whistle, right? And calls us back and says, "Sit there and wait." Now I feel shamed. I'm a grown man. You know, I'm like, what's going on here? Wow. So I sit there and I put my feet in the water. As I sit there, he says, "Your feet can't touch the water while you're sitting there." So I have to sit crisscross applesauce. So there I sit, crisscross applesauce, and the manager of the whole water park comes and pulls us aside and looks at us and says, "Were you standing up on the ride?" And I said, "I was squatting." No, wasn't standing all the way. And one of our students said, yeah, I was standing up. I was like, and then one of our students said, I didn't, sir. I was sitting there the whole time. And in the end, we received a little bit of grace. Praise God, we didn't get kicked out of the park, because that would have been miserable, sitting in the hot parking lot while everybody's in the water park having fun. But the manager said, you're not allowed on this tower on either of those two rides the rest of the day. I'm going to inform all of my lifeguards, and if they see you, you're out. Now, I think about this. There was the one that was standing all the way up, fully engaged in something he wasn't supposed to be doing. And then there was me. I was doing something I wasn't supposed to be doing, like, absolutely. But then there was the one that was doing exactly what he was supposed to be doing, and he got the same penalty as all of the rest of us. And if any of us would have looked back at the one that said, if you don't stand up, you're a wuss. If we would have looked back and said, sit your butt down, what would that have turned out to be like? Because we were all bound to each other. We were responsible for the actions of one another. And that's how it is with the church. Brothers and sisters, every single one of you, all of us, you and me, have something of purpose that God has given us to do in this world. And none of us can neglect that responsibility, because if any of us do, the mission of the church will not be as fully fulfilled as God desires it to be. Everybody has their part to play. And if any of us fall short, then God doesn't receive the maximum glory, honor, and praise that he so richly deserves. So we're at this critical juncture in every single year. We always come to this moment, this back-to-school moment, and it's a chance for us to remember that all of us have a fresh opportunity. Students, you're going back to school. And when you go back to school, there's an opportunity for you to carry your gifts there, gifts of kindness and generosity and mercy and fellowship and friendship and hospitality. You can be a friend for someone who so desperately needs it. I want you to know that when you go back to school this week, you're going to meet someone that you never knew before. And many of them are going to have been coming into your school, and they have no friends and they know nobody. And it's an opportunity for you to be that welcoming kindness that they so desperately are hungry for. Students, as you go back to school, you have responsibility. Parents, you have responsibility and opportunity in the stands. Whatever those stands look like, whether it's for football or for band or for baseball or for cheerleading or dance or whatever it is, wherever you are, all of a sudden your kids are going to be on a new team, and there are new parents that you have an opportunity to have a new interaction with. And if you would honor God with the way in which you fellowship with those individuals, God can be glorified with it. Workers, you have an opportunity in a new rhythm. I was laughing with a friend recently. They said that summers in America have become like Europe. That all of a sudden, everyone in America just takes the summer off and just leaves. They do tons of remote work. A person I was talking with manages a bunch of people and says it's impossible to get anyone to do anything during the summer. And so, but then school comes back, and rhythms are restored, and interfaces offer a new opportunity. So how are you going to utilize that gift? That gift of fellowship and relationship that are so critical, that people are yearning for. And even in this room today, we have some college students that are about to head back to college or go to college for the first time. College students, you don't cease to be a part of the body of Christ when you leave this place. As you go out into the world and enter into a college campus, you have influence over your classmates. You have opportunity to bless, to love, to care, or not. Let us not be a people that forget that we belong, forget that we have purpose, but rather let's use our gifts for the world so that God would be glorified. The ultimate aim of the church, the body, is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And now our opportunity is to use our individual gifts for that purpose and aim. Brothers and sisters, let's not miss this opportunity, but rather let's lean in. Take full advantage of it. All so God would receive the glory. Would you pray with me? Lord, we come before you thankful for your church, thankful for the body of believers that we have been baptized by your Spirit, that we have come into an intimate relationship with you. And so, Father, I pray that you would use the gifts of this, your people, for your glory in this community and beyond. Lord, we need you. We need to know what it is you're calling us to do, who you're calling us to be, and how we are called to bless. Father, help us to be unified in this mission. Help us to know that we could trust that we're not in this alone, but we have brothers and sisters here in this fellowship and beyond that are a part of your body that are all pursuing this same aim. Lord, we love you, and we want to hear from you now. Specifically in this time, Lord, we acknowledge that each person's gifts are unique, that you have blessed us each as individuals, and you have purpose for us as individuals. So as we enter into this time of listening, Lord, we pray that you would center our hearts and quiet us long enough for us to hear from you, that we would specifically hear what you are calling forth in our lives, the gifts that you have given, and how you're calling them to be used. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Church, we're going to sing a final song together. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing this out. It's going to together. One thing we can do as a body is lift up our worship.
We have one more thing to do. If you are going into sixth grade this year, would you go, come on up to the front? If you're coming into sixth grade, this is a very special year in our promotion here at Covenant because these students move from Cove Kids now into our Summit Student Ministries. And so we're going to celebrate you. And now you have Jeremiah as your leader. So you move from the lovely Jen and Amber Nicole to Jeremiah. Oh, no. But we're so excited for all of you. And we have Seth, one of our high schoolers here. He's going to offer a blessing over you. So if y'all would extend a hand and blessing over these sixth graders, would you do that at this time?
Hey, you church.
There you go. Nope. Right there.
He can't even get it.
Okay. There you go.
That'll work. Well, church, I invite you to bow your heads with us at this time.
Dear God, thank you so much for your beautiful children that you have put on this earth here. You have given each and every one of them a very specific purpose. You are all-powerful and all-knowing, so I pray that you would guide these sixth graders as they start this next chapter in their lives. Teach them wisdom, teach them love, show them who you are, and let them know, come to know your love and understand who you are. So, dear God, it is all of this that we as a body of Christ come together to pray. In your name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Amen.